You're listening to the audio production of Failing Forward, Turning Mistakes into Stepping Stones for Success. This abridged audiobook was written by John C. Maxwell, published by HarperCollins Leadership, and read by the author.
Chapter 1. What's the main difference between people who achieve and those who are average? What makes achievers excel? Why do some people skyrocket while others plummet? You can call it luck, blessing, or the Midas touch. But the truth is that some people just seem to achieve incredible things in spite of great difficulties. It doesn't matter what kind of work they do. Wherever they are, they just seem to make things happen. Certainly, all people like to think of themselves as above average, but achievers seem to leave average in the dust. But what makes the difference? Why do some people achieve so much? Is it family background? Having a good family growing up is not necessarily a good indicator of achievement. High percentages of successful people come from broken homes. Is it wealth? No. Some of the greatest achievers come from households of average to below average means. Is it opportunity? Two people with similar gifts, talents, and resources can look at a situation and one person will see a tremendous opportunity while the others see nothing. Opportunity is in the eye of the beholder. Is it high morals? I wish that were the key, but it's not. I've known people with high integrity who achieve little, and I've known scoundrels who are high producers. Is it the absence of hardship? For every achiever who has avoided tragedy, there's a Helen Keller who overcame extreme disabilities or a Viktor Frankl who survived absolute horrors. So that's not it either. None of those is the key. When it comes right down to it, I know of only one factor that separates those who consistently shine from those who don't. The difference between average people and achieving people is their perception of and response to failure. Throughout our time together, I want you to continually think of what I have just shared with you. In fact, I want to repeat it again, because it's the most important statement in the entire book. The difference between average people and achieving people is their perception of and response to failure. Nothing else has the same kind of impact on people's ability to accomplish their desires. How people see failure and deal with it impacts every aspect of their lives. Yet that ability seems difficult to acquire. Most people don't know where to start looking to get it. I haven't always been good at failing forward. It's certainly not something they tried to teach me in school. Take a look at some of my previous attitudes toward failure and see if your experience was similar. First, I feared failure. On the first day of class, when I was a college freshman, one professor walked in and boldly declared, "Half of you in this room will not pass this class." What was my first response? Fear. Up to that time, I had never failed a class, and I certainly did not want to start. So the first question I asked myself was, "What does the professor want?" School became a game that I wanted to win. Second, I misunderstood failure. As a child, I thought failure was a percentage. 69 and lower was failure, 70 and above was success. But failure isn't a percentage or a test. It's not a single event. It is a process. Third, I was unprepared for failure. When I graduated from college with my bachelor's degree, I wasn't at all prepared for what was ahead of me. I found that out in my first job. As the pastor in a small rural church, I did everything the people might expect of me and then some. But to be honest, I was as concerned about getting everyone to like me as I was with helping people. In the type of church I led, each year the people vote to decide whether to allow the leader to keep his job. And the leaders I had met loved to brag about the unanimous affirming votes that they received from their people. So imagine my surprise when the votes came back 31 yeses, one no, and one abstention. It was at that moment that I realized what an unrealistic view I had of success and failure. And as I've helped leaders to grow and develop through the years, I've seen that most people are in the same boat. In Leadership Magazine, J. Wallace Hamilton states, failure is far more common than success. Poverty is more prevalent than wealth. And disappointment, more normal than arrival. Right now, you're getting the chance to sign up with me for a class you never got a chance to take in school. One on failure. Because in life, the question is not if you will have problems, but how you're going to deal with your problems. Are you going to fail forward or backward? When I think of people who were able to look trouble in the eye and forge ahead, one of the first who comes to my mind is Mary Kay Ash. I admire Mary Kay. She overcame a lot of obstacles in her career, and she never let failure get the better of her. Mary Kay's first career was in direct sales, and she was quite successful. But she also found that it was difficult for a woman to progress in a corporate world, especially in the 1950s and early 1960s. So after 25 years of success, she decided to retire. But that didn't last long. By the time a month passed, she was stir crazy. She was ready to start her own business. She decided on a cosmetic business that would give every woman who worked in it unlimited opportunities. She purchased the formulas to the best beauty products she ever found, worked up a marketing plan, and prepared to set up her corporation. It didn't take long for her to hit her first obstacle. When she visited her attorney to set up her corporation, he insulted her and predicted her failure. She got similar treatment from her accountant. Despite their attempts to discourage her, she moved ahead. She sank her $5,000 life savings into her new business. She put her husband to work on the administrative side of things as she worked feverishly to prepare the product, design the packaging, write the training, and recruit consultants. But then a month before she was open for business, her husband died of a heart attack right at their kitchen table. Most people would never have been able to go on after that, but not Mary Kay. She kept going, and on September 13, 1963, she launched her business. Today, the company has over $1 billion in annual sales, employs 3,500 people, and empowers 500,000 direct sales consultants in 29 markets worldwide. Despite circumstances, obstacles, and hardship, Mary Kay Ash failed forward. I don't know what kind of obstacles you're facing in your life right now, but whatever they are, it doesn't matter. What does matter is that your life can change if you're willing to look at failure differently. You have the potential to overcome any problems, mistakes, or misfortunes. All you have to do is learn to fail forward. If you are ready to do that, let's begin right now. Step one in failing forward is to realize there is one major difference between average people and achieving people. Chapter 2. Get a New Definition of Failure and Success. On August 6, 1999, a Major League Baseball player stepped up to home plate in Montreal and made another out, the 5,113th one of his professional career. If a player were to make all of those outs consecutively, he would play 8 seasons without ever reaching first base. Was the player discouraged that night? No. You see, earlier in the same game, that player had reached a milestone that only 21 other people in the history of baseball have ever achieved. He had made his 3,000th hit. That player was Tony Gwynn of the San Diego Padres. During that game, Tony got on base with hits 4 times in 5 tries. But that's not the norm for him. Usually, he fails to get a hit 2 times out of every 3 attempts. Those results may not sound very encouraging, but if you know baseball, you recognize that Tony's ability to succeed consistently only 1 time in 3 tries has made him the greatest hitter of his generation. And Tony recognizes that to get your hits, you've got to make a lot of outs. One of the greatest problems people have with failure is that they are too quick to judge isolated situations in their lives and label them as failures. Instead, they need to keep the bigger picture in mind. Someone like Tony Gwynn doesn't look at an out that he makes and think of failure. He sees it within the context of the bigger picture. His perspective leads to perseverance. His perseverance brings longevity. And his longevity gives him opportunities for success. If you can change your perspective on failure, it will help you to persevere and ultimately achieve your desires. So how should you judge failure? Let's start by taking a look at seven things failure is not. Number one, people think failure is avoidable. It's not. You've heard the saying, to err is human, to forgive divine. Alexander Pope wrote that over 250 years ago, and he was only paraphrasing a saying that was common 2,000 years ago during the time of the Romans. Things today are the same as they were then. If you're a human being, you're going to make mistakes. Number two, people think failure is an event. It's not. Growing up, I thought that success and failure came in a moment. The best example I can think of is taking a test. If you got an F, it meant you failed. But I've come to realize that failure is a process. If you flunk a test, it doesn't mean you just failed a one-time event. The F shows that you neglected the process leading up to the test. In 1997, I wrote a book called The Success Journey. The thesis of the book is that success is not a destination, not a place where you arrive one day. Instead, it is the journey you take. And whether or not you succeed comes from what you do day to day. In other words, success is a process. Failure works the same way. It's not some place you arrive. It's how you deal with life along the way. Truly, no one can conclude that he's failed until he breathes his last breath. Until then, he's still in process, and the jury is still out. Number three, people think failure is objective. It's not. When you err, what determines whether that action was a failure? The real answer is that you are the only person who can really label what you do a failure. It's subjective. Your perception of and response to your mistakes determine whether your actions are a failure. Number four, people think failure is the enemy. It's not. Most people try to avoid failure like a plague. But it takes adversity to create success. NBA coach Rick Pitino states it even more strongly. Failure is good, he says. It's fertilizer. Everything I've learned about coaching, I've learned from making mistakes. Number five, people think failure is irreversible. It's not. There's an old saying in Texas, it doesn't matter how much milk you spill as long as you don't lose your cow. In other words, mistakes are not irreversible. The problems come when you see only the spilled milk and not the bigger picture. People who see failure correctly take it in stride. Number six, people think failure is a stigma. It's not. Mistakes are not permanent markers. I love the perspective of Senator Sam Ervin Jr. He remarked, defeat may serve as well as victory to shake the soul and let the glory out. That's the way we need to look at failure. When you make mistakes, don't let them get you down. And don't let yourself think of them as a stigma. Make each failure a step to success. Number seven, people think failure is final. It's not. Even what may appear to be a huge failure doesn't need to keep you from achieving. Take a look at the story of Sergio Zayman. Zayman, who successfully introduced Diet Coke, was also the same person who introduced New Coke. That move was an abysmal failure that lasted 79 days and cost the company about $100 million. People hated New Coke, and it caused Zayman to have to leave the company. But Zayman's problems with New Coke didn't keep him down. Eventually, the return of Coca-Cola Classic made the company even stronger, and in 1993, Zayman was hired back to the company. If you tend to focus on the extremes of success and failure, and to fixate on particular events in your life, try to put things into perspective. When you do, you'll be able to share the philosophy of someone like the Apostle Paul, who was able to say, I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. And that was saying a lot considering that Paul was shipwrecked, whipped, beaten, stoned, and imprisoned. Throughout everything, his faith enabled him to maintain perspective. The terrible truth is, that all roads to achievement lead through the land of failure. It has stood.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.